genetically
Stories in Berlin Season 3. Hello everyone and welcome to Stories in Berlin Season 3. I am Christina and in this season I read for you chapter by chapter, one chapter per episode, my novel The Berliners, a collection of semi-fictional stories about the life of Berliners during the corona pandemic. All stories take place on the same night in late November 2020 in a lockdown Berlin. Every chapter tells the story of a different Berliner. You shall find Season 3 on iTunes, Google Play, SoundCloud, YouTube and Podbean. If you would like to learn more about this podcast and the Story for Food project with which it is connected, you may visit storiesin.berlin and storyforfood.com. On social media, you may find us at Stories in Berlin and at Story for Food. If you would like to support this podcast and the Story for Food project, please consider a small donation via PayPal at paypal.me/storyforfood. Thank you all for listening. POLAT, the cocaine taxi. POLAT didn't like working in his family business. A second-generation Turkish in Germany, he had tried hard to escape the close-knit world of the Turkish immigrants in Berlin. He was the only one in the family to go to university and he moved out of home as soon as he found a job. His two older brothers, on the contrary, had never left the family home. Both of them were working on their father's taxi and hanging out only with other Turkish men. In fact, it was an open secret in the family that Polat's brothers were part of a Turkish mafia gang dealing drugs. Polat had never engaged in any conversation with them about their illegal activities. Neither did he know what exactly they were doing, nor did he want to know. During the first corona lockdown in Berlin, Polat lost his job as an apprentice engineer. Soon afterwards, his girlfriend left him and he had to move back to his family home as he couldn't afford a flat on his own. He had been looking for engineering jobs unsuccessfully and meanwhile, he was doing some afternoon shifts on his father's taxi. One November day, with the second lockdown set in place and the nights in Berlin getting longer and colder, Polat's big brother was arrested. The following day, his other brother left home and went into hiding. Polat's father stopped going out. He was ashamed of his sons being drug dealers. Polat's mother was crying and cursing Berlin all day for having turned her children into criminals. And Polat, however he may have longed to run away from his family, was found obliged to take up the family business and work on the taxi, sometimes for up to 12 hours per day. What he couldn't suspect at that point, though, was that his brother's activities were closely tied to the taxi business. One day, Polat's second brother caught up with him at the taxi stand. "Tonight I'm gonna need the taxi," he said. "What for?" Polat asked unsuspectedly. "For business," his brother replied seriously. Early that night, Polat passed the taxi to his brother for 3 hours. Then he picked it up and continued his shift. "Be there tonight at 11," His brother whispered and pat him on the shoulder as he left. And when later on POLAT found a small paper in the left pocket of his jacket with the address Corinne Strasse 61, he felt a sudden kick in the gut. It was a cold, starry night in late November. Around 10:15 p.m., POLAT picked up an old man from Schöneberg, direction Prenzlauer Berg. That should work just about fine, POLAT thought, as Corinne Strasse was also in Prenzlauer Berg, and if traffic permitted, he could make it there by 11. The old man was silent during most of the ride. He was a stout man, around 70 years old, well-dressed and serious. Maybe a little bit too serious, POLAT thought, when their eyes met briefly through the rearview mirror. Then again, POLAT continued his stream of thoughts, he may simply be sad. Just before reaching the destination, the man said, almost in an undertone, "As a matter of fact, I was wrong." "Excuse me?" uttered POLAT as the car turned to the street the man had asked for. "I was wrong to come here." "Is it not the right address?" "The address is correct, but I shouldn't be here." POLAT stopped the car outside the building of Copenhagener Strasse 21, the address the man had given him when he embarked on the taxi. The two men looked at each other through the mirror. Finally, the old man spoke. "I don't have the courage." "How do you mean?" POLAT asked. "To speak the truth," the man confessed in a shocking burst of intimacy. "To speak the truth to the woman I love before it's too late," he continued. "It's never too late to speak the truth," was the only thing POLAT found to say. "You see, life is short. Even if you live 90 years, life is too short. And I'm running out of time." The man's voice cracked. POLAT didn't speak. He felt embarrassed from this unexpected confession of the old man and lowered his eyes. "Do you have a girlfriend?" the man asked. His voice sounded less troubled now. "She left me when the pandemic started. I lost my job and she left me. She even left Berlin. She went back to her parents in Stuttgart. She got too afraid." "Of the corona or of you?" "Of the pandemic, I suppose. Everyone got scared with the situation. Not everyone left their partner because of the corona, though." "You have a point here," POLAT said reluctantly. "You know, fear is the other side of love. She left you not because she got afraid of the pandemic, but because she realized she didn't love you enough to share her fears with you," said the old man, who didn't seem to have any intention to get out of the taxi. €18.50. POLAT hit the taximeter as a way to stop this uncomfortable conversation and get rid of the stranger. But the old man continued. "I'm telling you this because I did exactly the same. I also left my wife when the corona started. I was too afraid that I will die next to the wrong woman." "And who is the woman of Copenhagener Strasse?" "A friend, an old lover. I don't even know if she still lives here after all these years." "There is a way to find out," said POLAT, hoping that the man should step out of the taxi. Yet, once more, the man showed no intention to move. "Do you find me odd?" the man asked feebly. POLAT didn't reply. Yes, he found him odd indeed. He had opened up too much about his private life, He had spoken a lot and then again not enough, as if a confession or a secret was still hanging on the air, waiting to be shared. What's the use of talking to strangers about your personal affairs? Polat thought to himself. Last month, I thought I was dying, the old man carried on. I was lying in a hospital bed with a tube in my mouth, and all my life passed before my eyes. 72 years in less than 10 minutes, I saw the people I cared about, those I lost, those who matter and those who matter not. Polat was drawn into the man's story, waiting quietly for him to hit a conclusion, to make a decision, to dare some action. He was so greatly captivated by the man's words that, even if it was uncomfortable sitting there with a stranger who didn't want to come out of the taxi, he was enjoying their exchange in a mysterious way. So much that he completely lost track of time. It was 10:55 when Polat checked his watch. Suddenly, as if out of deep sleep, he remembered the appointment of Corinnerstrasse. I'm so sorry, Polat interrupted the old man who had gone into recounting his brief affair with a woman of Copenhagenerstrasse, his only true love, as he called her. I'm sorry, but I need to go. I must be somewhere else in 5 minutes, Polat repeated kindly. Is it far? Asked the man. It's in Corinnerstrasse, few streets away. I'm supposed to be there at 11. Take me with you, said the man, and Polat didn't give it a second thought. He started the car and in a few minutes they were outside the building of Corinnerstrasse 61. It all happened so quickly that Polat didn't really have the time to envision what to expect from the appointment of Corinnerstrasse that his brother had set for him. And much less did he have the time to question the old man's behavior and whether it was a good idea to bring him along. When they arrived at Corinnerstrasse 61, they found a young couple waiting at the front door. Before coming out of the car, the old man grabbed Polat's shoulder in an attempt to hold him back. Let's leave, the man whispered almost in agony. It was a sudden and incomprehensible gesture from the part of the old man, and Polat couldn't grasp the meaning of it. Yet, he didn't worry too much about it. Everything in that man was awkward and puzzling. Everything that night seemed mysterious. Polat turned to the man to reassure him. I won't be long, I just need to pick up something for my brother. Then I can drive you back to Schöneberg. When Polat came out of the car, he immediately felt that something was wrong. I am here from the part of Amos, he said quietly as he approached the couple. The woman looked at him firmly in the eyes and said, good. And that was all. On the spot, six men appeared out of nowhere. They came out of two cars parked on the opposite street side and surrounded Polat from behind. He turned to them, pale and confused. Yet, already playing in his mind the possibility that they were members of his brother's narcotics gang. Police, one man said and showed Polat his badge. Everything that followed took place in silence and at a remarkable speed. The policeman opened the trunk of the taxi, found a backpack with 42,000 euros and 1,200 grams of cocaine. Then they handcuffed Polat. He didn't speak. As if he had known all along that his taxi was part of a cocaine service. It had never crossed his mind that his brothers were actually using the taxi to traffic drugs. Yet it made absolute sense that they would. How is it that POLAT had never thought of that before? And what could he possibly say now that he didn't know about the gas and cocaine in the trunk? That his own brother had framed him? Who would believe that? Just before POLAT entered the police car, the old man came out of the taxi. His face looked distorted with pain. His eyes searched for POLAT's eyes, but POLAT kept his head down. He couldn't stand the sad, inquiring eyes of the man on him. He was ashamed. And the shame he felt on that moment far outpassed his fear and anger. As if the man had been an old friend, a father figure even, and POLAT had betrayed his trust. When POLAT was inside the police car, he saw the old man talking to one of the policemen. It didn't look like an interrogation, though. It rather looked like the old man was giving instruction to the policeman. As if the old man was himself a policeman. This thought confused POLAT even further. Could the old man, with his stories about courage and love, with his soft voice, with his transparent, honest eyes, actually be the orchestrator of a plot against POLAT? And if so, why? Why him in all cases? His only crime was to have been born in a poor household within an immigrant community with two older brothers in drug trafficking. On the way to the police station, POLAT's mind was on fire. Unanswered questions bombarded him. Who was the old man? Was there any truth to his stories? And the woman of Copenhagener Strasse? Did she really exist?